رب زدني علما. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قل أرأيتم إن جعل الله عليكم الليل سرمدا إلى يوم القيامة من إله غير الله يأتيكم بضياء أفلا تسمعون. قل أرأيتم إن جعل الله عليكم النهار سرمدا إلى يوم القيامة من إله غير الله يأتيكم بليل تسكنون فيه أفلا تبصرون. ومن رحمته جعل لكم الليل والنهار لتسكنوا فيه ولتبتغوا من فضله ولعلكم تشكرون. ويوم يناديهم فيقول أين شركائي الذين كنتم تزعمون. ونزعنا من كل أمة شهيدا فقلنا هاتوا برهانكم فاعلموا أن الحق لله وضل عنهم ما كانوا يفترون. صدق الله العظيم.
الحمد لله. As we all know, inshallah, we didn't give a specific title to this lecture. As we said, we are going to make the topic open to the Sheikh. It is just a word of nasiha that is going to be given by the Sheikh to the brothers and sisters in the various aspects of life. So there is no specific topic. This lecture is going to, this nasiha is going to take place from now until Maghrib prayer, and immediately after the Maghrib prayer, inshallah, as we all know, we are going to the AFO, the Masjid prayer for Jumu'ah, and we will pray Maghrib there. After that, inshallah, the question and answer section is going to take place, and papers will be distributed to the brothers. So anyone that has question in any matter, you can write it, and inshallah, the Sheikh is going to clarify it. I will directly, inshallah, hold the Sheikh to the stage so that I will give him the opportunity to start delivering this word of nasiha.
Jazakallah khairan. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. وبارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. أما بعد, my dear brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. I'm very thankful to Allah تبارك وتعالى for giving me this opportunity and this chance to spend this short time with you in this citadel of learning. It's my first time here, though it's not my first time in Malaysia, but this is the first time I'm visiting this area of Malaysia and coming to this institution of learning. And it gives me great pleasure to be in your midst. Young people pursuing useful knowledge, inshallah, because the future is going to be the future, you are going to be the great actors in shaping the future by the permission of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. So it is indeed a great pleasure to have this interactive session with you. And as our able brother Bukhari, our brother Bukhari said, there is no topic for the talk. So it is just words of counsel, words of nasiha, which is the essence, which is the essence of religion, which is the essence of our deen. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the famous hadith which you all know, Ad-Dinun Nasiha, hadith Tamim Abu Ruqayya, Tamim ibn Aus al-Dari, Ad-Dinun Nasiha, that the religion is good counsel, as though the whole aspects of religion have been narrowed to be in good counsel. And definitely it is so, because Allah has described most of the prophets with this quality. Like Allah said regarding Sayyidina Nuh alayhi salam, wa ansahu lakum wa a'lamu min Allahi ma la ta'lamun, I give good counsel to you. And he said regarding the prophet Hud, wa ana lakum nasihun amin, I am a good counselor to you, a trustworthy one. And he says regarding Shu'aib, in uridu illa al-islaha mastata'at, I only want to do good, and part of doing good is doing nasiha. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has described his relationship to us in this in a famous hadith where he says, "Inni mumsikum bihujazikum," I am holding fast and firm onto the your loins, so that you don't fall away from me. You know, even when you want to hold somebody firmly so that he does not escape, you hold him by his belt. That's why even the police now, that's where they hold somebody, because you can't run away. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said that I am holding fast onto that part of your body so that you don't escape and fall off and go into the fire. And that was why in the largest assembly, during the farewell pilgrimage, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told the assembly, the largest assembly of Muslims during the farewell pilgrimage, that you will go back to Allah and Allah is going to ask you regarding me, what are you going to say? They all said, "Nashhadu annaka ya Rasulallah qad ballaghta wa addayta wa nasahta." We bear witness, O Prophet of Allah, that you have indeed delivered the message, and you have fulfilled the trust, and you have done good counseling. So this is just some few words about the importance of good counseling. This is something which the prophets do, and which when we come together, we do it to ourselves, because there is a lot of benefit in it. As Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala said, "Fadhakkir fa inna dhikra tanfa'ul mu'minin." You give a reminder, that is, you remind the believers, because reminder, it benefits the believers. So may Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala make these minutes that we are going to spend together to be of benefit to all of us, inshallah. So since it is they are words of good counsel, I'm just going to speak generally on what will be of benefit to us all, inshallah, and what will help us in our life, especially in what we are doing presently, which is the pursuit of knowledge, and also the level of the stage that we are in our life, which is the stage of youth, the stage of utmost mental and physical strength. Because as Allah has told us our creation goes through a cycle, which starts with a state of weakness and childhood, then it goes to the stage of full strength, then it goes back to a stage of weakness and old age. Now you are in your upmost. You are just now in increase. You are in increase. So it's just like a car that is accelerating. When there is acceleration, there is utmost force. And then you will reach your peak. Then gradually you will start decelerating. You go back to the edge of weakness. Now this is a stage of your life that is very, very important, because it is one of the times that you will be asked about. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said in the hadith of Abu Huraira, that la tazalu qadama abdin hatta la tazalu qadama abdin hatta yus'alu an arba, the feet of a person shall not cease to be in front of Allah till he is asked on about four things. And he mentioned about among those things, wa an shababihi fima afnah, he will be asked of his youth, in how did he end it, how did he finish that stage of his life. So these are the two things, these are the things that I kept in mind when choosing what I'm going to talk to you about, which is the fact that you are seeking knowledge, and also the fact that you are in the prime of your life. The most important thing that a person, a human being, in his position as a human being, whether he be a child or he be an adult, or he be in his old age a senile person, whether he is male or female, the most important word of counsel for a person as a human being is to keep his relationship with Allah, is to have a good relationship with Allah, a good relation with Allah. That is, that what is between you and Allah, it's okay. Once that is okay, then you are okay. Once what is between you and Allah is okay, then you are okay. Because that is the essence of your life. That is the essence of why you came here. You didn't choose to be alive, you were given life by Allah. You didn't choose to be born a male or female, that was decided by Allah. You didn't choose who your parents were going to be, that was decided by Allah. So everything that you have is from Allah. That's why Allah said, وَمَا بِكُم مِّن نِعْمَةٍ فَمِنْ اللَّهِ, whatever you have of favor, it is from Allah. And that is true, that is absolutely true. Because you came into this world with nothing. You came into this world as nothing. وَاللَّهُ أَخْرَجَكُم مِّن بُطُونِ أُمَّهَاتِكُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ شَيْئًا وَجَعَلَ لَكُمُ السَّمْعَ وَالْأَبْصَارَ وَالْأَفْئِدَةَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. Allah brought you out of the wombs of your mothers without having knowledge of anything. You knew nothing. Then he gave you hearing and sight and speech so that you will be thankful. So this is your reality. You were before then zero. You were before then non-existent. هل أتى على الإنسان حين من الدهر لم يكن شيئا مذكورا. Has the time come to man when he was not something to be mentioned? That is, he was non-existent. So this is your reality. Now, when you think of this, that you were nothing, and then Allah gave you everything. He gave you parents who had patience over you, who showed you love. When you cried, everybody will be sleepless. When you smile, everybody smiles. When you are happy, everybody is happy. You are just taken from loving arms to loving arms. You didn't do that. It was Allah who moved the hearts of your parents to do that. So this This is your reality, which makes you appreciate what Allah has done for you. And this is why the followers of all prophets, they are the best of human beings, because they realize why they came here, they realize who they are, and they have answers to the fundamental questions. Many people, they can't answer these questions. Why am I here? What brought me here? Why are things happening the way they happen? Or why did they happen the way they happened? And why will they continue happening the way they are happening? These answers, you only get it from the people who follow the prophets of Allah, because they are the ones who received guidance, because they are not answers which you can get from the laboratory. They are not answers which you can do some, which you can solve some equations to find answers to those questions. And they are not answers which you can just speculate about, because you can't speculate about something which you do not know. They are not answers which the philosophers will give you answers to. All what the philosophers are saying, the so-called metaphysical questions, they are just conjectures. And that's why Allah always is challenging that, and yet he always attacks, he always puts it to the rejectors of the messages of the prophets, and he describes them with what is their true description, that إِنْ يَتَّبِعُونَ إِلَّا ظَنَّ وَإِنْهُمْ إِلَّا يَخْرُصُونَ. They only follow but conjecture, and they are just groping about in darkness, which is true. People who read philosophy, I haven't read much of philosophy since when I was young. I was influenced by the writings of some of the scholars of Islam who gave stern warning about it. I used to love to read about it, especially the writings of some of the critical thinkers like Kant and so on. But I didn't read any metaphysical questions by the philosophers, except what our scholars, especially like Sheikh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah, used to talk about. But definitely from what our scholars of Islam have brought, from what the philosophers are saying, you can see that they are just following conjectures, and that's why they are never saying one thing as in contradistinction to what the followers of prophets are saying, because their statement is one. But the philosophers, they have got so many divergent opinions. They are never in consensus over any fundamental question, as the followers of all religions are in consensus over many issues. They are in consensus over the existence of Allah, all the revealed religions. They are in consensus over this. All the revealed religions, they are in consensus that there is life after death. All the revealed religions, they are in consensus that there is prophethood. But you can't take any fundamental question and find such a consensus among the philosophers. Sorry, this is just a digression. So the followers of all prophets, they are the ones that are the best of human beings, because they realize who they are and what they are doing here. So the most important thing is your relationship between you and Allah, because that is what you came to do here. You have a trust between you and Allah. You are not created as a human being except after accepting to fulfill a trust between you and Allah. And that is why all the faculties that Allah gave you, they are the things that are going to help you to fulfill the trust. And you are going to be tried to see whether you will fulfill it or you will not fulfill it. When you keep your relationship between you and Allah perfect, then everything about you is going to be perfect, because you are doing what you came to do here. You are doing what you came to do here. You see, there are laws that Allah has put in creation. These laws there are laws which you are compelled to follow them. You are compelled to obey those laws. You are compelled to eat so as to live. You are compelled to breathe so as to live. You are compelled to sleep so that your brain will have some rest. These are all physical laws which you are following, just like other creations are following the physical laws. You see, there is order in the world. The rising of the sun, that's why we're able to make calendars. We're able to write the times of prayer. Today, which is, sorry, I would have made an introduction to mention the time and the date. Now I just remembered about the date when I was trying to bring an example about the date. Today is the 12th of, today is the 18th of Safar, the 1435, which corresponds to the 21st of December 2013. Now in this place, the sun rose at a specific time, and next year, on a day like this, on the 21st of December, the sun will rise exactly at that time. That's why we are able to make calendars. There is no doubt, and that's why we are able to write the times of prayer of each and every place, and you can simulate it in a computer, and a computer can give it, can give the times of prayers for the whole century for you. Why is the computer able to do that? Because there is order. There is order. Things, they don't happen haphazardly. Now this shows that there are physical laws that we are compelled to follow. Now, as a human being, you are influenced by these physical laws, because your brain has a clock that is influenced by what is happening, by the surroundings around it. If you follow the laws that you have a choice to follow or not to follow, that is the laws, the social and behavioral laws, if you follow the laws that are in conformity to the laws of the one who constituted the physical laws, then there is harmony. You are in harmony and you will be at peace. Now this is what Allah has said, drawing our attention to realize this fact, to use our intellect. He said, "Afa ghayra dinillahi yabghun wa lahu aslama man fis samawati wal ardi taw'an wa karha wa ilayhi yurja'un." Do they seek a religion other than religion, than the religion of Allah? While it is to Allah that the heavens and the earth and all that are in it have submitted, tawan, willingly, wakarha, and unwillingly, and they are going back to him. That is, everybody, all that is in the heavens and the earth, willingly and unwillingly, they submit to the laws of Allah, these so-called natural laws. Everybody submits to it. So are you looking for another set of law other than the law of Allah, the religion of Allah? So this is the essence of why you must keep good relation between you and Allah, observe the limits of Allah, observe the laws of Allah, so that you'll be in harmony. You'll be in harmony with nature, you'll be in harmony with the natural laws. Now this issue is very, very important in life, because life situations, they are varied, there are so many. You have a situation of ease and you have a situation of hardship, and everybody goes through this. Everybody, whether a Muslim or a non-Muslim, he has times of ease, he has times of hardship. He has times of health, well-being, and he has times of illness. He has times of richness, he has times of poverty. These are cycles. أَمْ حَسِبَ الَّذِينَ يَعْمَلُونَ السَّيِّئَاتِ أَنْ يَسْبِقُونَ سَاءَ مَا يَحْكُمُونَ. Those who are doing evil deeds, do they think that they are going to escape from us? That is, they will not be tried. Everybody is tried. So the relationship that you have between you and Allah is what will guide you through these events. So the most important thing is for you to have excellent relationship with Allah in whatever situation you are in. The believers during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when they were in during the Battle of Uhud, it was a great trial for them. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was injured. 70 of his companions were killed. People's faith was shaken, that how could we be defeated when we are fighting for the cause of Allah and the Prophet of Allah himself is with us? How could this happen? They were bewildered. But Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala has a wisdom. He did that to show to them that the most important thing for a believer in his life is to guard his relationship between him and Allah. That is the most important thing. Because if something happens to that, despite all other causes, you should expect the unexpected. They said Allah reminded them, أَوَلَمَّا أَصَابَتْكُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ قَدْ أَصَبْتُمْ مِثْلَيْهَا قُلْتُمْ أَنَّا هَذَا قُلْ هُوَ مِنْ عِنْدِ أَنفُسِكُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلَىٰ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٌ. When a calamity befalls you while you had the chance to inflict double that kind of calamity on your enemies, you started saying, أَنَّا هَذَا, how did this thing occur? How did it occur to us that will be defeated while we are fighting for the cause of Allah and the Prophet of Allah is with us? How could anna hada, how could this happen? Then Allah said, قُلْ هُوَ مِنْ عِنْدِ أَنفُسِكُمْ, it is from your own selves. It is from your own selves. Allah chose to give a lesson. And we are always reciting Surah Ali Imran to remember that lesson. Why? Because they went against a single command of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said to a party of the believers, you remain in this position. Don't move away from it. Whether we are victorious or we are defeated, don't move away from here. And they disobeyed. And when they disobeyed, Allah chose to give them a very tough lesson. And this lesson is that your success and your victory is not by your strength, it's not by your strategy, it's not by your intelligence, by your ability, by your wealth, by anything, it is by Allah. And if you keep your relationship with Allah okay, then Allah will fulfill to you his own side of the bargain, because it is a contract. Let us make no mistake about this. What is between us and Allah in our life is a contract. We are in a contract. As Allah has said, Inna aradna al-amanata ala samawati wal ard. We have presented the contract of trust to the heavens and the earth and the mountains, and they refused to take it and they were afraid of it. But mankind took it. So we are, let's not make any mistake about it. We are on a contract between us and Allah. And whatever happens, this should be our interpretation of what is happening. You know, things happen and people have varied interpretations. There is the materialist interpretation of how things occur. And then there is the interpretation that is based on divine guidance. Now the interpretation based on divine guidance is to look at things happening based on the trust that is between you and Allah. So this thing that happened to the believers during the Battle of Uhud, the ayat that came in Surah Ali Imran, it was to give an analysis of the whole thing. And so as to prevent the materialist interpretation of happenings of history. So if you keep your duty to Allah, then Allah will fulfill his own part of the contract. This is why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he taught this lesson to even small children. Ibn Abbas, Abdullah ibn Abbas was the Prophet's cousin. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam died, Ibn Abbas was about 13, 14 years old. So by the time that he kept company of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was around 10, 11, 12. Actually, he came to Medina 4 years before the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, 4 or 5 years. So he was like 9, 10 when he came to Medina. One time, he was riding on the back of the Prophet, on the back of a donkey, which the Prophet was riding. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said to him, "Ya ghulam, inni u'allimuka kalimatin fahfadhunna." Oh, you small boy, I want to teach you some words. Remember them. Memorize them. And he said, "Ihfadillaha yahfadhka." Guard Allah, guard the affair of Allah, guard your relationship with Allah, and Allah will guide. Allah will keep guard of you. That is, preserve the relationship between you and Allah will preserve you. So this is a very fundamental question. This is, you see, there is, you should think deeply over this as one of the natural laws. Just as you have the physical laws, the natural laws, the physical laws of the rising of the sun, the falling of the sun, the alteration of night and day, and the cause and effect, that is, you need to eat so as to keep yourself alive. When you are suffering pain, you need to take some pain relievers so as to raise the level of pain consciousness in your brain. These are all cause and effect. They are the laws of Allah. These are fundamental laws. Take as one of the fundamental laws this hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because as Allah makes reference to what he calls the sunanullah, the pattern, the laws of Allah, or the custom of Allah. What is meant by the custom of Allah, which he says does not change? These are fundamental laws that do not change. So take this as a fundamental law and think deeply over it. Ihfadillaha yahfadhka. Keep your duty to Allah, preserve the right of Allah, and Allah will preserve you. This is a fundamental law, and make it the basis of interpreting what happens to you and whatever does not happen to you as well. One of the scholars of Islam, he said, when I commit an act of disobedience, no matter how little it is between me and Allah, he says, I used to see it even in the behavior of my wife towards me. Sometimes you will have serious family problem, and you will even start looking for counseling, going to the counselor. I mean, I'm not saying that going to the counselor is not good. There are situations when you need to do that. But sometimes, you know, it is just a trial because of what has gone wrong between you and Allah. And then he says, when I realize what I did and I turn to Allah in repentance, then I wouldn't know till things have then things are just all right between me and my wife. This was narrated from Hassan al-Basri, one of the pious predecessors. So keeping your duty to Allah is very, very important, especially when you are in the when you are engaged in an activity which you know it needs not only your strength, but it needs a lot of support, like you are in now. You know that your study, you don't just rely on your mental faculties and your mental strength and the fact that you are revising and attending the classes and so on, but you need a lot of support. You need a lot of support to make it. In a situation like that, the source of the strongest source of support that you need is your relationship with Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, is what is going to give you success and what is going to give you support. You know, your situation is just could be likened to the situation of people in a battlefield. Umar radiallahu anhu, Amir al-Mu'mineen, he used to tell the soldiers of Islam when they were going for battle that, remember, you are not people who get victorious in war because of your multitude, because of your number, nor because of your military strength, nor because of your military strategy. You gain victory because of your fear of Allah. So he says, beware that Islam will suffer a defeat on account of what one of you is doing. That is, these are people who are going for jihad, they are fighting for the cause of Allah, and they are being given this counsel that they should fear Allah, not to go, that is, maintain the good relationship between themselves and Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, because they need it most. Because at that time, when they do not observe that relationship with Allah and something bad happens, the consequences could be very bitter, which is defeat. Defeat is terrible, because defeat can change the course of history. A military defeat can change the course of history. So in such a situation, he used to warn them about this. So this is very, very important in whatever we are doing, that we maintain a good relationship between ourselves and Allah, and especially in a state of ease. Because when people are at ease, they lose guard. When you have what you want, you lose your guard, and you want to do, out of showing happiness, there is some element of exuberance. You can observe it from a football team. When a football team, when they win the cup, not only the members of the team, but people who love the team or even the whole country, they go into celebration. And there is a lot of free for all thing. Anything happens, because people just want to do whatever they want, no restrictions. Now, during that kind of time, that is the time when you are supposed to say, wait a minute, what am I doing? What am I supposed to do in such a situation? And this is what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the second part of the hadith, ta'arraf ila Allahi fi ar-raha ya'rifka fi ash-shidda. That is, be known to Allah during the time of ease, then Allah will know you during the time of hardship. During the time of ease, when you have made, you have passed your papers, you've got a very good grade, the tendency for some is to throw up a party and spend the whole night merrymaking and cutting off all restrictions, not observing the limits of anyone, even if they are the limits of Allah, not minding about that. Why? Because they are happy, they got what they wanted. Now that is the most dangerous thing, and that is the time when you should watch out, because such a trial could be very costly for you. Now, if on the other hand, during such a time, you become known to Allah. What does it mean to become known to Allah? You observe the limits of Allah. You show thankfulness to Allah that this thing that has come to you, it is not because of your effort, it is not because of your ability, it is just because of the favor of Allah. How thankful I am to Allah. I didn't know anything. I didn't have the ability. You see your weakness, and then you see all the favors of Allah surrounding you. So you feel greatly thankful to Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. And instead of throwing a party or doing something like that, you stand up You pray two rak'ahs of thankfulness to Allah. You do the sujood, the prostration of gratitude to Allah, sujood shukr for that. Even if it's just the sujood shukr that you did, you extended some element of help to people who are in need of help to show gratitude to Allah. Then when the time comes, because the difficulty will definitely come, because life is a cycle. A time will come when you'll have disappointments. At that time, Ya arifuka fi shidda. Allah will know you at that time. So brothers and sisters, the most important thing, I could talk for a long time. I just realized I have talked for quite a long time on this issue. But because it is very central to our life, and because I want us to really be thinking deeply over it and regard it as one of the fundamental rules of life, and also the basis of our interpretation, of interpreting whatever is happening and whatever is not happening. This is very central to our life, especially when we are engaged in such an endeavor, which is seeking knowledge. Then the second thing that I wanted to do to counsel us about is the most important aspect of relationship between us and Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala is the prayer. The prayer is the most important thing, because once you keep it, then you will surely keep all aspects of relationship, of the rights of Allah over you. As Sayyidina Umar has said, Inna ahamma amrikum indi as-salah. The most important affair of all, the most important of all your affairs is prayer. Whoever keeps it and observes it, then he will definitely keep all the other rules. And whoever does not pay attention to it, then she will surely not pay attention to any other aspect of the deen. So that is, you make it as your gauge of your relationship with Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. How constant are you in observing the prayer at its appointed time and in congregation? You measure yourself by that. How constant are you in observing the supererogatory prayers before or after the obligatory prayers? Because these are things that support you are keeping the obligatory prayer. When you start being unmindful of it, gradually you will become unmindful of the obligatory one. So that is the most important thing. And make it as the litmus test. You know the litmus paper, huh? Of gauging acidity and alkalinity. Make it, use that as the litmus paper for you to gauge your relationship between you and Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. Then another important thing is for you to seize the moment. Make use of the time. Make use of the moment that you are in, because everything happens in your life. You don't know the maqdur. You don't know what is, you don't know the decree. So you just can't sit down and say, whatever will be decreed will be decreed, will happen. You don't know the decree. But by pursuing what you are, by pursuing what is going to benefit you, then the decree happens and that is it. That is how the life occurs. So you have to seize the moment. Make use of your time, because this period that you are in is a period which is very, very important in life. Since you are going to be asked about it, it's a very, very important period of life. So make use of it to achieve a lot. Your capacity is tremendous, it's immense. Nobody achieves anything by just whiling away the time. You know, of all the things which I saw sometimes ago in the BBC, they were having a competition of the one who laughs for the longest time, for the longest period. And they were laughing and laughing, and they were using a stopwatch to gauge the one who will laugh for the longest time. But I don't know, I have not had a competition where somebody is, they want to know the one who has slept for most of his life. the one who has slept for the greater part of his life, not to say maybe the one who can sleep for 20 hours at the same time. No, for the greater part of his life, he was just sleeping, and he will be given a prize for that. Have you ever heard of that? I don't know, but I expect our human beings, based on their intellect, they will not descend to that level of lack of knowledge, because it doesn't make sense. So you don't achieve anything by just sleeping and just whiling away the time and leaving it happen. You achieve by working. That's why Allah says, وَقُلْ اِعْمَلُوا. Work. فَسَيَرَ اللَّهُ عَمَلَكُمْ وَرَسُولُهُ وَالْمُؤْمِنُونَ. Very soon Allah will see your work, and His Prophet will see, and the Messenger will see your work, and the believers will see your work. So you have to work. Because Allah, this is part of wisdom. Allah has put cause and effect. This thing happens because this thing happens. This thing happens because these things happen. So you have to observe that in order to show respect to the roles of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. You don't just sit down and say, you don't just sit down and just say, I will just be praying to have A's in all my subjects. And you don't attend the classes, you don't read, you don't revise, you don't prepare for exam. You say, I am praying. It's never seen like that, because it is true, Allah does everything. But then part of what Allah has said, He has asked you to follow these rules that He has said. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam has said, "Ihris ala ma yanfa'uka." Pursue what is going to be of benefit to you. You should pursue what is going to be of benefit to you. Wala ta'ajaz. And don't be an imbecile, someone who is ignorant of these rules of cause and effect. So you have to work hard. I mean, you left, most of you here, most of the people, most of you here, you are foreign students. You left your parents, you left your loved ones, you left where you are known and where you are appreciated. Here you come, no matter the position that you are given outside, here nobody recognizes you there. All that is seen is that you are just a student with such a number in such a department, that is all. So this is it's a lot of sacrifice that you are making, so you have to make it worth the while. You have to make it worth the while, and that is by seizing the moment. And remember, when your intention is sound, you are given reward with Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala for anything that you do, even if it has got no connection with the religion, apparently. For instance, you are in software engineering, but your aim of getting a good degree in software engineering is to become a very good human being, to make use of your time, to make it a source of getting a good employment, that you will protect yourself and protect your family and do good to others. And you intend that you'll make use of that knowledge to help the religion of Allah, to help the slaves of Allah. You have all these good intentions in your mind. And whenever you sit down to prepare for your lessons or to prepare for your exam, you are going to be rewarded by Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Because all these things that I mentioned, these are good intentions. And you are given the reward of what you intended. وَإِنَّمَا لِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ مَا نَوَى. Every human being will get what he intended. So if you intended good, you'll only get good for that. One time, Imam Malik, he was sitting with his student, Abdullah ibn Wahab. Then the adhan for Dhuhr was called. They called the prayer to Dhuhr prayer. So Ibn Wahab, he had some slates, some wooden slates, where he has recorded a hadith that he was reciting in front of Malik. Immediately he heard the call to prayer, he gathered the slates. And so Malik said, what are you doing? He said, the call to prayer, I want to do the sunnah. He said, what an amazing thing you are doing. The thing that you are leaving, the thing that you are leaving behind to go and do the other thing, that other thing that you are doing is no lesser than the thing that you are in. That is the prayer that you want to do, the sunnah, that you are, what you are doing, that is of seeking knowledge, is no lesser than what you are gathering your slaves to go and do. You are staying in front of the teacher and learning is no lesser in terms of reward than what you are gathering your plates to go and do, which is the prayer of sunnah. Because as the prophet of the companion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Mu'adh ibn Jabal, has said, mudhakaratul ilmi tasbih, that is revising knowledge is tasbih. When the sahaba and the tabi'in, when they say tasbih, what they mean by tasbih is sunnah, is salatun nafila, that is the voluntary prayer. So have this intention that when you are preparing for your exam, or when you are trying to solve a problem, when you are trying to understand, when you are reading, to memorize, to imbibe what you learned, bear in mind that if your intention is good, it is just like you are doing Salatun Nafila. Because even though Imam Malik, he said this regarding the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but every other aspect of knowledge, if the intention is sound, it's just the same in terms of making it as an aspect of ibadah. Definitely in terms of excellence in the position of Allah, knowledge of Allah is higher than knowledge of what leads to the knowledge of the natural laws of Allah. So, but in terms of ibadah, when the intention is sound, they are all acts of ibadah. And this is what Imam Shafi'i mentioned in Kitabul Umm regarding the knowledge of medicine. Regarding the knowledge of medicine and its importance. So this is also very important. Make use of your time and realize that you are in ibadah. And there are many, usually, the whole life, whenever you set a goal, you have many things to divert you away from your goal. And especially at this stage of your life, when you are in your young age, you have many things to divert you. Beware of them. Beware of those things. Remember one thing, that shaitan is a reality. Shaitan is a reality, he's for real. He's not imaginary. He exists. And he whispers into our hearts. And he has soldiers. He has helpers. Allah has described them as infantry and cavalry. He has cavalry, those who come mounted. And he has the infantry, those who come on foot. And he has access to our hearts, and he sees us from where we do not see him. Were it not for shaitan, people will not swerve away from their goals. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam narrated on the authority of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. This is a hadith Qudsi. This is the way it is narrated. He narrated on the authority of Allah. That is, Allah is, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying that Allah has said, Inni khalaqtu ibadi kullahum hunafa. I created my slaves, all of them, on the straight path, based on the perfect creation. Fajitalathum shayateen. Then the devils, the shaytans, they came to swerve them away from that path. Wa ahallat lahum ma haramtu alayhim. And they made permissible for them what I made impermissible. And they were made impermissible for them what I made permissible for them. So they will not leave you alone. The shaitans will not leave you alone. So you have to battle with shaitan, and the best way to battle with shaitan is to seek refuge of in Allah from his evil. You don't see him, so you can't fight him. But be conscious when he's whispering in your heart that this is shaitan. So turn away from the whispering of shaitan. And whenever he whispers, seek refuge of Allah from his whispering. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ اتَّقَوْا إِذَا مَسَّهُمْ طَائِفٌ مِّنَ الشَّيْطَانِ تَذَكَّرُوا فَإِذَا هُمْ مُبْصِرُونَ. Those who fear Allah, whenever a whispering from shaitan afflicts them, تَذَكَّرُوا. The Mufassirun, they have two tafsir of this. تَذَكَّرُوا, they become aware. That is, they remember and they become aware. And the other tafsir is تَذَكَّرُوا, they mention the name of Allah. Both are correct. When they are afflicted with a whispering, they become aware, so they seek refuge. They remember the name of Allah, فَإِذَا هُمْ مُبْصِرُونَ. By the time they do that, they become on a clarity. So everything becomes clear, and they are saved from the evil. You have many things to tempt you. You have many temptations, and Shaitan has got many friends, many associates, and he uses them to turn you away from your goal in life. Don't let him. Seek the help of Allah. Seek strength from Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, and do a lot of dhikr. Do a lot of remembrance of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, because that is how you will be protected. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he mentioned to us that the Prophet of Allah Yahya alayhi salam was sent to his people with 5 commandments and 5 parables. Allah asked him to command his people with 5 things and to give them 5 parables, that is 5 examples, 5, a parable is what they call a mathal, that is an analogy. The 5th thing, which is what I want to mention, which is the point that I want to make, he says, I command you to remember Allah. This is the commandment. He said, because the parable, that is the similitude of the one who remembers Allah, is like the one who is pursued by his enemies. And they are pursuing him. Then all of a sudden, he came and he entered a city that is well fortified. And they couldn't have any access to him. So he says that the most protected state that a person can be in is when, from the evil of shayateen, of the devils, is when he is in a state of remembrance of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. So keep remember Allah a lot. Keep the adhkar al-sabah wal-masa, the dhikr that you do in the morning and the dhikr that you do in the evening, when sleeping, after prayer, when going out of your house, when coming in, when wearing clothes, when entering the market, all this that have been taught to us by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, observe them and you will be protected. This is very, very important, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he reminded us based on this, and he said that I am also commanding you with these things, which he mentioned that Yahya ibn Zakariya alayhi wa ala abihi salatu wassalam, he commanded his people and he set a parable for them. And with this, I will come to the end of the words of counsel that I wanted to give to us. These are for me as well as for you, because we never say enough in terms of reminding ourselves. The person that has a heart that is alive is the one who reminds himself, who reminds himself, because you are going to, it's part of recording, it's part of making recording of yourself before a time will come when you will be reckoned. So it is good for you, for a person to always just say, wait a minute. Aina tadhhabun? Where then are you going? Where am I going? What is happening? It is always good to make this, to do this, to make this kind of reflection, so that at least you will gauge yourself and always do the litmus test to know where you are. So we ask Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala to bless our lives, and we ask Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala to give us a good life and an excellent ending of Iman in Allah and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and may he make our final statement La ilaha illallah. And we ask Allah to give us help in what we are doing, my brothers and sisters who are students here a useful education with good grades to excel. And definitely when you keep your relation with Allah, you will excel inshallah. Sallallahu alaihi wasallam wa baraka ala abdihi wa rasulina nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in.